This is Tom O'Brien, the Mental Health Herbalist, today with an interview with Dr Peter McPherson, who is a medical doctor and medical herbalist. And we're going to have a conversation about his journey to becoming a herbalist, as well as his experience of integrated medicine and the challenges posed by, I suppose, trying to build a bridge between the medical model, allopathic medicine, biomedicine, and natural medicine, herbal medicine, and so forth. So, Peter, welcome to this interview. Great to have you here today.
Thanks very much. Yeah, always a pleasure. Always a pleasure.
So tell us a little bit about yourself. Just give us a bit of your background.
Yeah. So, well, I think probably like many of us who find our way in the complementary medicine field, it's not what I intended to do when I was an 18-year-old school leaver. I went through a very well-defined path, I suppose. I started off studying science, which was good, and I enjoyed it, and I quite liked the rigor of that process, I suppose. But at the end of it, I realized there weren't an awful lot of jobs. So I then decided, well, medical school could be a good way to go. So that's what I did. So I trained as a doctor. And I suppose really, like a lot of things, whilst you're a student, you're protected from the realities of a profession a certain amount. And after graduation, I kind of really began to realize that there were a lot of patients that we weren't treating terribly well. By that, I mean the method of treatment. And I kind of thought to myself, you know, there really has to be a better way to do this. These drugs, the side effects are worse than the disease itself in many cases. So sort of almost serendipitously, I found myself in New York, as you do, and ended up working part-time at New York Presbyterian Hospital, which was a large multi-campus hospital across New York, in fact, New York State. And they had an integrated medicine clinic, which I got involved in. And this was probably really, the first time I ever probably had met an acupuncturist or an aromatherapist or a naturopathic doctor. And we got involved in these quite substantial case conferences where patients would have been referred to us, an awful lot of mental health casework, where they may have had treatment-resistant depression, as an example, and they were really getting to the point where perhaps ECT might have been their only option. So then this kind of multidisciplinary integrated team would have got together, looked at the case notes and come up with a treatment plan, and you would have had input from the psychotherapist and the aromatherapist and the naturopathic doctor. And I suppose really because my background was quite scientific, it was the naturopathic approach that kind of appealed to me most. I understood a bit about plants, not a lot, but a bit. And she really encouraged me to kind of progress with this. So that's what I did. I did some extra training in herbal medicine. And that was great. Problem was, when I came back to the UK, I realized that there wasn't anything really in terms of a well-established integrated medicine approach, other than perhaps sporadic pockets across the country. So really, from that point, I then went into research for a while because it was a bit more secure, and I remained an academic for most of the time since that. But over the past perhaps 10 years, I've started to move back slightly more into clinical work. And now I'm at the point where I suppose I approach patients with the mind of a medical doctor, but my prescription pad is herbal. I don't use any allopathic drug treatments. I might use some allopathic methods, so for example, x-rays, blood work, those kind of things. But in terms of prescribing, it's all herbal with a nod to any other allopathic drugs that might be taken. So it's integrated, I suppose, in that respect. And that seems to work quite well for me so far.
So when you became a doctor and you had your first experience, and you were saying that, you know, some of the treatments maybe weren't as effective as you might have imagined or wanted, and did you become disillusioned with medicine, or what was that experience like? That must have been challenging.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, in medicine, particularly in allopathic medicine, it's brilliant at acute cases. So if you have something acutely wrong with you, you are going to want to go to hospital. If it's sepsis, you're going to want antibiotics. If you need surgery, you're going to want surgery. But where modern medicine really, I suppose, has lost its way slightly is in the treatment of chronic conditions. And very often, particularly when I've been involved with GP practices, you would have a patient come and they would have a chronic illness, so irritable bowel syndrome, for example, and really the treatment options that were available to them through allopathic approach were quite limited. And so it really became almost a case of prescribing placebos that weren't placebos. So there were placebos that had side effects. And that for me, I found quite frightening, actually. I mean, as medical herbalists, we go to extraordinary lengths to ensure there are no plant-drug interactions. Yet it seems to me certainly to be in allopathic medicine that you have this idea of polypharmacy, where patients may be on 10 different types of medication without any real recognition of interactions that may occur between those. So it was kind of instances like that. And when you are prescribing 17-year-old girls antidepressants and not really checking their progress, so they may be on it for the next 10, 20 years, that to me really did seem like very poor practice. Not necessarily criticizing all the many GPs and consultants are out there. They're constrained, I suppose, by the almost the business model that the current healthcare system follows. And I think that was it. You know, medicine became more about target setting and less about treating patients. And of course, when you work in herbal medicine and integrated practice, you have the luxury of being almost private healthcare. You can take hour-long consultations with a patient if you want, or longer perhaps sometimes, as the case may be. And I think that's very beneficial to patients. They need to feel listened to.
When you were kind of going through that change from, you know, considering, you know, the medical approach, the allopathic approach, and then you were introduced to herbal medicine, did you find that there was much reflection going on in medicine within the profession? Like, were people talking openly about these things, or is that not really happening?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting. There certainly is a generation of, let's say, GPs who within their training would have been exposed to plants as medicines. They would have probably studied some pharmacognosy, as would have been, and pharmacists of that generation would be the same. There then kind of is the in-between generation who are very much the pharmacological model, very much the pharmaceutical industry-driven model. And now with newer graduates, it's starting to come full circle again, where there is a little bit more recognition of there is more than a prescription pad. And I think we see that probably most especially in psychiatry and mental health. I mean, we know that, for example, psychotherapy was not regarded as part of conventional medicine 20 years ago, whereas now it has been absorbed within the model. So I think there is starting to be a little bit more of a recognition. And actually, even if you look at something like the NICE, the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, they actually recommend certain complementary therapies in part of their guidelines. So if you look at treatment of migraine, for example, you kind of go through the list of drugs. And then at the end, it says, if they don't respond to this, recommend 6 courses of acupuncture. And actually, for something like NICE, a government-funded organization to recommend that, that's quite significant, I think. If it were funded, it would be even better. But, you know, there are limits to funding, I suppose.
And so then when you were in New York, you had this experience working in a clinic that was, I suppose, an integrated medicine clinic. So maybe just for viewers, what is integrated medicine?
I think it's almost the perfect nexus of all of the complementary therapies and all that they have to offer, and actually all of the allopathic specialties and what they have to offer. So, for example, if you were going down a conventional medicine route and you had non-specific pain in, say, your head, you may see a neurologist because it could be migraine related. You may see a max fac surgeon because it could be dental jaw related. You may see a pain specialist. You may see a psychiatrist if there's a psychosomatic element. There are all of these different medical specialties who come together in that model. And equally so in the complementary therapies, we really should have something similar. So you should have the medical herbalist working with the nutritionist, working with the acupuncturist, working with the aromatherapist. That's not always the case. There can be this kind of tribalism, but for integrated medicine to work, everything really does have to come together. And that's difficult. It's difficult because we're separated quite often by geography. In the States, there is very much a tradition of having everybody in the one place on the one campus, and that makes it much easier. You have cross-pollination of ideas and case conferences, and much easier to get good treatment plans. Here in the UK and in Ireland, there is, of course, no statutory registration of many of the complementary therapists. That creates problems around funding. We are, generally speaking, quite isolated in the way we practice, and I think the lack of any specific direction as well, it kind of almost goes against it as a model here in this part of the world. If you have patients who are constantly coming to GP with chronic conditions that appear to have no resolution, and the GP has a really quite limited toolkit which they can access, I have found that they're actually only too willing to have another option. The difficulties, of course, is you have socioeconomic barriers. If somebody can't afford those kind of treatments, then you have this disparity, and that's something which I think I'm probably slightly uncomfortable with. And very often I end up giving treatments away for free because there's need, and sometimes it is the right thing to do.
Tell us a little bit about your journey into herbal medicine, say in Northern Ireland.
After I had been back for about 5 or 6 years, I was pretty sure that I didn't really want to re-enter conventional medicine in that full way, and we're quite fortunate in the UK that the General Medical Council that we're responsible to do allow you to remain on a register without actively having a license to practice. So you retain some rights as a physician, but not full rights. So that was kind of where I left myself for a while, kind of deciding, would I go back? Would I stay as an academic? And then I suddenly realized, oh, wait, there's a third option. And the third option was, of course, private practice in medical herbalism. So it was very much a dipping a toe in the water initially. I started off working in a multidisciplinary clinic, actually, where I still remain, where there are psychotherapists and an acupuncturist and aromatherapists and Mike Timoney specialists. And I found that the most useful way, A, first of all, to get patients, because it is fundamentally, there's some kind of business model there, but also you have support of people who have experience working in this type of field in a part of the world which can be quite insular, a part of the world where ultimately what the doctor says is right, it's gospel truth, and you can't question it. I think perhaps from my point of view, because I had recognition as having a medical background, that did offer me some leeway and some currency. And I think very often patients are maybe slightly surprised when they come into my clinic and we see blood results and I see their cholesterol is 7, and I say, well, we'll not worry about that too much. Let's focus on these other things, which would be very different from the narrative from a GP. I found that having some, I suppose, formal recognition in medicine has helped in Northern Ireland. If I was still in the United States, I think it would be completely irrelevant, actually. I think a naturopathic approach certainly is very well established in many of the states of the United States. And in actual fact, an awful lot of naturopaths can prescribe allopathic medicines as well. And some of them actually act as midwives and in these other specialist roles. So I think that influence that I had in the States did inform what I did and what I do actually here to a certain extent. As with all aspects of any profession, it is about building a network. So you get to know GPs who are perhaps more inclined towards complementary therapies, and those who are slightly bit more hostile to it, and you can therefore, I suppose, turn patients into your own ambassador. So you can kind of empower and embolden them to be upfront with their GP and consultant and say, yeah, I'm seeing this guy's medical herbalist. He's saying do this. And then they kind of contact me, and then I am able to use the lingo, I suppose, that they're comfortable with. And that probably helps too, I think.
We met in the Herbal Medicine Ireland Facebook group that I'm the kind of administrator on, and I had posed the question kind of, facetiously or naively or semi-optimistically, what's the role for herbalists in hospitals? So I suppose that was the start of the conversation about, down here in the Republic of Ireland, there isn't really this conversation going on, and I suppose sometimes you have to imagine things for them to happen. So, by trying out the question, we came across each other and we started this conversation. It shouldn't be unrealistic to explore a role for some natural and complementary medicines within the, the hospital system. But obviously there are a lot of challenges because of the influence of the pharmaceutical company over hospitals, over medicines, over the training of doctors, and over the practice of professions. You know, different professional groups are funded in different ways and supported in different ways. So I know it can be quite challenging for people within medicine to think outside the box a little bit. What do you think, is that something that could be realistic in the future, or is it doomed to be two separate domains? You know, medical, allopathic in one, and if you want to go natural, you go outside.
I think there probably very necessarily will have to be some tension between the two, because if you have a patient who has had quite negative experiences within the allopathic traditions, the last thing they're going to want to do is to come to a medical herbalist or an aromatherapist who is just working in a hospital, and they're just seen as another type of doctor or healthcare professional. So I think it is good that there is some separation. However, I think equally so, it would be good if there is a referral system or some kind of formal but loose association initially. I mean, we do have the integrated medicine clinics at UCLH in London. That did suffer a bit when funding was withdrawn by the government. But equally so, I mean, there are medical herbalists who work in hospitals. Alex Laird of Whips Cross in London works in dermatology clinic. That works quite well. I know Anita Ralph in Kent works quite well with a consultant oncologist in breast cancer. And there are probably many others. I think very often it's the case is you do quite uniquely have to find that niche and find the corresponding GP, consultant, whoever it happens to be, who is amenable to what you can do. And when you start to do that, it does open doors. And by doing that, that is how then we can get a move towards integrated medicine. There are challenges working in hospitals. I've worked in quite a few hospitals in quite a few different places, and they are quite rarefied environments. And it sometimes, in my mind, would be difficult to see how a medical herbalist would work in that environment. But I suppose an outpatient's clinic would be the ideal environment, as opposed to being involved in acute medicine, rehabilitation, stroke wards, those kind of places, yes, for sure, but perhaps not in accident emergency or those types of environment. But I mean, the potential is there. The potential is definitely there. And I think as we are having new generations of nurses, pharmacists, doctors, physios, all of the profession being slightly more aware of what's happening, then when they get to management positions within the various trusts and health services, they maybe can affect change. So by making the effort to try and give some kind of almost public service education at the minute and bring it out there, then perhaps it can catalyze some kind of change that happens.
Okay, so there's hope. As I say,
there's
maybe
always
hope, but maybe realistically, as you say, outside the hospital setting in outpatient clinics or other health settings or community settings.
They take it from there on a case-by-case basis. I'm happy to help out in any way. And if it's not something I can do, I will find somebody who can do it and refer them on. And that's the nature of the business, I think. That is true integrated medicine, actually.
And the last question I want to ask you, for me anyway, this time of the year is a good time to start foraging. Do you get out of your academic setting and your clinic? Do you like to get out and forage a little bit? Or
I live in Ballycastle, which is beside the sea. So we have a sea, we have a forest. So it's surprising, actually, how many native plants you can find. In Northern Ireland, a great favourite is nettle soup. And, nettles for really a whole range of different illnesses. I mean, it's quite the panacea almost, but also plantain. When we get towards the autumn, acorns and those kind of things, I mean, it's all there. And actually, gorse Which wouldn't be used an awful lot in herbal medicine, but it's part of the Bach's flower remedies. So, you know, there is an association there with a sort of nervine action. It's a lovely bright plant, so it cannot but be full of flavonoids and things which are useful. So I do sort of almost use it in a similar way to perhaps rose, Rosa damascena, or some of the other sort of floral type nervines. Albizia would be a kind of another equivalent, I suppose. It works quite well. Sometimes you do come across the slight escapee from a garden or something like that. There was an old hospital in this town, which I'm sure did have a physic garden at some point in its history. But it's mostly all been built over now. So any of those precious Victorian plants would have long disappeared. But I think, yeah, it's important to try and use some native plants if you can, and encourage patients to go out and have a look around, identify correctly, for goodness sake, but, you know, give it a go. Everybody likes picking raspberries and blackberries from the hedges and things like that, and they do you good as well.
Tell us how people can find you, where you're based, and how they can contact you if they want to see you.
My clinic is based in Coleraine, which is in the north coast of Northern Ireland, a lovely part of the world to come and visit. And what we can do, if anybody wants to get in touch, we can maybe put a link just below the video on YouTube. And within certain bounds, I'm quite happy to do consultations initially via Skype or Zoom or those kind of things.
Peter, listen, I really appreciate you taking the time out today to do this interview and share your experience and knowledge. It's really interesting, and it's great to support people to think about natural ways to approach health and well-being and illness and disease, to reduce people's suffering. And so you're doing a great job there, and courageous man to go down that path. Wish you well, and it's good to connect with you. So hopefully we'll keep crossing paths on our journey ahead.
Absolutely.
So we bring this video to the end. So thanks, Peter, for this video, and if you have any comments, drop them in the comment box below, and I'll leave a link to Peter's clinic in the description box, and I'll see you in a video very soon. Take care.